अस्सलामु अलैकुम वरहमतुल्लाहि वबरकातुहु।
गुड डे स्टूडेंट्स, होप यू आर ऑल फाइन इन योर होम एंड यू आर डूइंग वेरी वेल एंड यू आर मेंटेनिंग सोशल डिस्टेंसिंग एंड आइसोलेशन एज यू नो ऑर्डर बाय द गवर्नमेंट। सो टुडे वी विल स्टार्ट अ न्यू चैप्टर दैट इज हेरिडिटी एंड एवोल्यूशन। Heredity and evolution. Okay, before starting the chapter, I will just say you before that evolution is just a hypothesis. It's a hypothesis because why it is a hypothesis, we'll talk about this later. So first, let us discuss what is heredity. What is heredity? What do you understand when you listen the term heredity? You have heard it a lot of times, right? Suppose a person, for example, his father recently passed away, so he inherited the property of his father, right? Means what? The wealth his father had, it is now his. Automatically he inherited it. So similar is in the case of our system, not only our system, the system of every living organism. That means what heredity means? Inheritance of something from parents to offspring. Okay, inheritance of something. It can be wealth, property, it can be characters. It can be anything that is inherited from parents to offspring. Now, what is offspring? Offspring means what? Nothing but their children. This is heredity. So in this chapter we will learn that how offspring inherit characters, inherit certain traits from their offspring, inherit certain traits from their parents. Now the next term is evolution. Evolution is the process of gradual change from simple to more complex that take place for after a long period of time. So evolution means what? Changes, gradual change from simple to complex, and it takes a very significant amount of time. Not 1 year, not 2 years, not 50 years, not even 100 years, it takes thousands and thousands of years to see a visible evolution, to witness a visible evolution. So that is why we say it's just a hypothesis, because nobody lives for that much long time. So they just collect information and data from different sources and correlate and link with one another, and they establish a relations, right, of evolution. Okay. Now what is heredity again? Inheritance of something from parents to offspring. But in this case, in the context of this chapter, we will define it as inheritance of characters. Characters from parents to offspring. Now in order to understand heredity, it is very important to know who was Mendel. Mendel was a priest in Austria. His full name was Gregor Johann Mendel, and he postulated the law of inheritance. He postulated certain points of inheritance which was later compiled into law of inheritance. He didn't directly give all those laws, he just given some postulates, and later it was compiled into the law of inheritance by certain other scientists. Now, before starting any further about Mendel and his laws, let's understand few terms in heredity. So, few terms, you need to understand few terms. Now, the first term we'll be talking about is trait. What is trait? Trait means characters. Trait means, characters, right? For example, the color of eye. It may be black or it may be brown. The color of hair, the color of your skin, right? The, shape of your body, everything is a trait, right? What else? For example, you can cite, yeah, the color of your skin, the color of your eyes, you know, the how your ears look like, you know, these are all traits, right? Okay, next is, now traits are of two types. Trait means what? The characters which you find in yourself are the traits. Now traits are of two types. One are inherited trait and another is acquired. So inherited traits are those traits that we inherit from our parents, right? Are inherit from our parents, like the color of our eyes is an inherited trait, the color of our skin, you know, some are inherited, and acquired trait are those traits which you develop, right? Suppose you are a gym freak, right? You like to go, you are a fitness freak, you like to go to gym and work out, right? Then you will develop a very good muscles and physique. That doesn't necessarily mean that your parents too had a very nice physique, right? You did work out and you did all the work and you developed a nice physique. That's your own acquired trait, right? Now you are very good at drawing, right? It's a trait. Drawing is a trait, and you know, you have practiced for years and years, and you have developed a very, you know, good skill of drawing. So these are all acquired trait. Acquired trait means what? Which you have learned by yourself. Now the next word we'll be knowing are genes. Now what are genes? So here we have said that traits are, you know, are the characters, and inherited trait are the characters that we inherit from our offspring. Now who carries this trait from our parents to the offspring? These are the genes. Genes are the carrier of the traits. Now one more word, that is offspring. I have already said means the, you know, the later the next generation, or the children, you can say, or the future generation, right? Suppose children of the parents or the next generation of two parents are termed as offspring or progeny. Offspring or progeny. Okay. Now before starting to understand Mendel, we have to know, well, what did Mendel exactly do in his lifetime. So Mendel, you know, he selected pea plant, and he performed certain experiment on that pea plant, and he came into some certain conclusion. So before understanding learning what experiment he did, it is very important to understand why did Mendel select pea plant. So first of all, it was just a mere accident. And secondly, it was discovered that, you know, pea plant had a lot of advantage. The garden pea plant had a lot of advantages, like, you know, it takes less time to complete one cycle, or to, you know, for developing. And number two, you know, it required less maintenance, and less time, obviously, we have said. And one more, the most important word, one is that it has a lot of contrasting characters. Yeah, contrasting character. This is a new term you are getting. So characters, you know, characters. Characters means what? If somebody is tall, if somebody is short, if somebody is fair, if somebody is, you know, heavy. These are characters. And contrasting characters, contrasting means what? Opposite of one another. So contrasting character always are, you know, mentioned in pairs, right? The opposite pair. Suppose tall plus dwarf. Dwarf is, you know, means short. Yeah. So tall and short are pair of contrasting character, right? Smooth and wrinkled. Smooth plus wrinkled. These are a pair of contrasting character. Means contrasting character are those character which are, you know, which counterbalances one another, which are opposite of one another. So Mendel noticed that, you know, pea plant had a lot of contrasting character, which also gave him advantage, because the more the number of contrasting characters are, the better the results are. So he So seven pair of contrasting character based on certain characters of that P plan. So those pair of contrasting character are, so let me draw a table for you. So the first character was based on seed shape. Seed shape. Okay, you can note it down. So I'm writing it in a okay, the first character, contrasting character, was based on seed shape. So Mendel saw that there are the seed of the P plant are of two types. The characters, there are two type of characters. The characters of seed that depends on seed shape are of two type. The seed shape may be either round, which is exactly round, or wrinkled. Means what? It's not perfectly symmetrical round. It's, you know, wrinkled somehow. Somehow not perfectly round. So the first characters, pair of contrasting character he found was based on seed shape, that is round and wrinkled. The second one was seed color. He saw two different type of seed color. It may be green or it may be yellow. Green or yellow. The third one was based on pod shape. Pod shape. Now what is pod? I think all of you have seen pea, right? The fruit of the pea plant, right? It comes in a, you know, sort it like a covering, right? Like a covering, box covering. This covering is nothing but pod. So he saw pod are of two types, inflated and constricted. Inflated and constricted. Inflated means what? The pod was nice and inflated means what? It was, the pod was nicely inflated. And constricted means what? The pod was had certain constriction like this. Okay, how many characters, contrasting character we discussed? Three. Next one is the pod color. The color of this pod. Pod color. It could be either green. It could be either green or yellow. Pod color, green or yellow. Next is the color of flower. Flower color. So the color of flower of pea plant were either white or purple. Flower were either white or purple. Now flower location. Flower location. They can be axial or terminal. Axial means what? If the flower, suppose this is the plant, if the flower is located on the stem or in the axis here, okay, I'm sure you are, might not be visible. Again, I'm drawing it because if the flower is located on the axis, this is axial, and if the flower, this is axial, and if the flower is located on the terminal region, means of the head region, this is terminal, right? Axial and terminal based on flower location. And the last one is the height. This is the most important one. Most of our experiment will be based on height. Height, he saw two types, tall and dwarf. Again, the seven characters are seed shape, it may be round or wrinkled, seed color, green or yellow, pod shape, inflated or constricted, pod color, green or yellow, flower location, axial or terminal, flower color, white or purple, and height, tall or dwarf. So these are the seven pair of contrasting character Mendel found in his, discovered in the pea plant, which gave him much more advantage. So now, trait we know, characters. Trait we know, character. Now we have seen every pair of contrasting character that Mendel discovered in the pea plant. Now, some pea plant had, you know, suppose take the contrasting character height, for example. Height may be tall or dwarf. So Mendel saw that in the pea plant, some plants were tall and some were dwarf, right? So when we'll discuss this later. So when he considered the contrasting character of height, he saw that in a certain time, certain trait gets expressed and one does not get expressed. So suppose a tall plant and a dwarf plant. A tall plant will have characters of TT, capital T, capital T, and a dwarf plant will have the gamete of small t, small t. Capital T, for dwarf it is small t, small t. So they will produce gamete, this one capital T, this one small t, and the result will be this one. So this is the parental generation or P1 generation, this one the F1 generation or first filial generation. This is the progeny. So when Mendel crossed one tall plant and dwarf plant, so one pure tall and pure dwarf plant, so he found out that the result was, you know, a genetic mixture of both the plant. But in reality, he found that the plant grew up to be tall. So he wondered, he crossed both tall plant and both dwarf plant, but the result was tall plant, right? So where is the dwarf character then? So the dwarf character is present here. If you look at the progeny of the first filial generation, you see it has both tall and dwarf gene, but the dwarf one is not getting expressed. Only the tall one is getting expressed, right? It is not that, no, it has suppressed the dwarf gene. No, the dwarf gene is present, but the tall gene is getting expressed. Now, why the tall gene is only getting expressed here? Because it is supported by nature, because the nature, it is more favorable to nature. So here, when both the gene is expressed and when both the traits are present, but only one of them getting expressed, we call it as a dominant trait. And the one which doesn't get expressed but it is present are known as recessive trait. As we'll progress through the chapter, it will be more and more clear to you. Don't worry. So let us take a look of Mendel monohybrid experiment. Before that, once again, when a pure tall and pure dwarf plant are crossed crossed, then the first generation which is produced is tall plant, where both the genes will be present, but the plant will express the characteristic of tall. So the characteristic that will be displayed is the dominant characteristic, and the characteristic that won't be displayed is the recessive characteristic. Now we will study the work of Mendel here. The first work is the monohybrid experiment. Now what is monohybrid? Why that the term is monohybrid? Mono means one. So mono means one. From the monohybrid, the experiment is said to be as monohybrid because only one set of contrasting character, are taken into consideration in monohybrid experiment. So here in monohybrid experiment, Mendel considered the characteristic of height, the contrasting character of height for example. So suppose in parental generation is short for P1 generation, the first parental generation. He took two plants. One is tall, one is dwarf. Tall has the characteristic. Yeah, this is the tall and this is the dwarf. Right? He considered a pair of contrasting character based on height, that is the tall and dwarf. One of the plant of parental generation was tall and the other was dwarf. Then he crossed them. So they produced, the tall one will produce gamete ST and the dwarf one T. He crossed them and the result of first generation was this one, which we said were tall. All the offspring of the first filial generation were tall. So when he crossed one pure tall and one pure dwarf, he found out that all the offspring of the first filial generation were all tall. Now, as I have said before, if you remember that although they are tall, but the characteristic of both tall and dwarf are present in the offspring of the first filial generation. Now, how we know this? How we know that the character is expressed? So, when Mendel, we'll discuss this later. Okay, now he did what? He took two individual from the first filial generation. So all the individual of first filial generation were tall, but they were not pure tall and pure dwarf. They were, you know, mixed. They had mixed. So he took this one. Okay, let me do it here. So it was parental generation, tall, TT, dwarf, small t, gametes are T, gametes is T, they cross and the F1 generation is T, which was tall. Next, in the second parental generation, he did what? In the second parental generation, he took two of the progenies of the first filial, two of the progenies of the first cross, that is both were tall, but when they will produce gamete, they will produce gamete separately. See, the characteristics of both tall and dwarf is present here, but it is not, you know, suppressed by one another. They are still independent, right? They can be expressed again. Now, when this generation got crossed, now the surprise happens here. So this one get crossed with this one. So this one again get crossed with this one. This one get crossed with this one. Again, this one get crossed with this one. This one is tall. This one is tall. This one is tall. This one is dwarf. Now, the point of understanding comes where you really have to focus. Here you really have to focus. So when pure tall, when we say pure tall, that means what? This will have pure tall genes. And when we say hybrid tall, it will have the genes of both tall and dwarf, but will express only the dominant one. This is the hybrid tall or impure. This is pure, this is impure, right? Okay. Now, here we see in the first filial generation, only tall plants are You know, there are only tall plants, but they were hybrid tall, not pure tall, right? A cross between a pure tall and a pure dwarf gave rise to a hybrid tall. When hybrid tall plant, we see the both the genes are present, but only the dominant one is expressed. And when two hybrid tall plant are again crossed, we see that the recessive, that dwarf that was recessive, that is not expressed in the first filial generation, that was not expressed in the first filial generation, is expressed at the end of second cross or in the second filial generation, F2 generation, in the end of F2 generation. So this again reviving of this character proves that when the offspring of first filial generation were all tall, so this proved that the character was there, but it was suppressed. This suppressed character expresses itself in the second filial generation. So, and in the second filial generation, we see one pure tall, we see two hybrid tall, and we see one pure dwarf. Pure dwarf. Okay. Now, listen very carefully. What is these are called? So, this capital T is tall. Capital T small t is tall. Now you have to understand what is exactly we are trying to say here. So this is tall, this is pure tall, we have said. This is tall, this is hybrid tall or impure tall. This is dwarf, but it is pure dwarf. Here it is, when we see it physically, the plant, in this both cases, in this pure tall and hybrid tall, in both cases we see the plant is tall. That means what? The plant is phenotypically or physically tall. It is tall, but okay, let me do it in a, okay, this is tall, this is also tall. It is pure tall and this is hybrid or impure. So this both are tall, so both are phenotypically tall. Means what? When we look at them, suppose a layman, he doesn't understand what is inheritance, what is Mendel, what is genetic, he does not know, understand anything. Just when he look at the plant, he saw that both are tall. So he saw the physical appearance. So physical appearance means the phenotype. But inside, if you look at the gene, we will see this is pure tall, but in this case, both tall and dwarf are present, but the, you know, dominant one, the tall one getting expressed. So this is known as genotype. Means when we take the gene into consideration, this is genotype. This is phenotypically tall, but this is not phenotype, but this is also phenotypically tall, but this is genotypically pure tall and this is genotypically hybrid tall, right? The genes are different, the combinations are different, right? So due to combination, when we talk about the combination, the genotype plays a vital role, but when we talk about the physical appearance, we talk about the phenotype. So a person having a phenotypic character does not necessarily mean that his genotypic character should also be the same. The genotypic character may be different, but the phenotypic character may be the same. Here we see the phenotypic character are tall in three cases and dwarf in one cases, but the genotypic character, if you look, there are three different type of genotypic character. One is pure T, one is capital T small t, another is capital T. These two are same phenotypically, you see. This is different genotypically, these two are different genotypically, and this is again different genotypically. So phenotypically there are two types of plant, but genotypically there are three types of plant. And at the end of the second cross, Mendel saw that when he observed the phenotype, he saw that the traits get expressed in the ratio 3:1. Suppose he took one tall and one dwarf. In the first filial generation, all were tall. In the second filial generation, he saw that the characters were expressed in the ratio 3:1. Means what? 3 dominant character and 1 recessive character. See, 3 tall and 1 dwarf here. 3 dominant character and 1 recessive character. So the dominant character will be more in number and the recessive character will be less in number. Again, phenotype means the physical appearance and the genotype means the combination of genes. Having similar phenotype does not mean it has the similar genotype as well. Now again, what is T. This one we have said as pure tall. Pure tall. This one we have said as impure tall or hybrid, right? Or hybrid. See, this one has only one type of zygote or one type of zygote. Yeah, one type of when it will form gametes, it will form only one type of gamete. That is only T. And when this one will form gamete, it will form T and T, two type of gamete. So since it is forming only one type of gamete, so it is known as homozygous. Since it is forming two different type of gamete, it is known as heterozygous. So only when only one type of gamete will be formed, it will be termed as homozygous. And when two different type of gametes will be formed, it will be termed as heterozygous, right? Homozygous, heterozygous, pure breed, impure breed. These both of them, now here we see both of them are phenotypically tall, but genotypically they are different. Now, Mendel's dihybrid cross. Dihybrid cross. Dihybrid again means two different characters will be taken into consideration and their two different type of characteristic will be taken into consideration and hence it is known as dihybrid. Remember all the pairs of contrasting character we were talking about in the beginning. So from there, this contrasting character, he took two sets of contrasting character based on the seed shape and seed color. Seed shape may be two type, either round or wrinkled, and seed color may be two type, green or yellow. Have you noted the previous table or previous characters which I have given? I hope you did. So round is represented as capital R, and wrinkled is represented as small r, right? And green is yellow is represented as capital Y, green is represented as small y. Now why it's not WW? Capital W and small w, why it is not capital G, small g? Because in most of the cases we will see, or it was seen, that round is the dominant trait and here yellow is the dominant trait. So we take the first letter of the dominant trait in consideration as a capital. The dominant one will be capital and the recessive one will be wrinkled, right? So here we will take, now in first monohybrid experiment we took one character for experiment. Here we will take two characters for experiment together. So if the parental generation have two pair of pure round yellow, one pair of pure round yellow and pure wrinkled green, again a pair with pure dominant trait and one with a pure recessive trait, two individual, one with pure dominant traits, pure dominant traits, one with pure recessive trait. So pure dominant traits are round,
right?
Round, yellow, yellow. And pure recessive traits are wrinkled, wrinkled, green, green. So this will be what? This will be naturally, it will be round wrinkled, round yellow. This will be wrinkled green. See, here the parents will be round yellow. We took a parent with pure round and yellow seed shape, and we took another parent with pure wrinkled and green seed shape. Now let's cross this. We took two characters, now let's cross this. Here the gamete will be produced, here will be one round and yellow. Here the gametes will be produced, will be wrinkled and green. Now when this will cross, what will happen? RY and RG, it will give rise to, see this one, round and round, yellow and green. So when in the first filial generation, we will get all the plants which have dominant characteristics of round and yellow, but it will be a hybrid, right? It will be hybrid. It will not have pure round and yellow as this, or pure wrinkled and green as this. It will have a mixture of all the characteristics, and the dominant one here is the round, and in case of the color here it is the yellow. Round and yellow. This is the parental generation. Again, in parental generation, we took pure round and yellow and wrinkled and green. The gametes will be produced are from this R, from this Y, from this small R, small Y. When there will be cross in the F1 generation, round yellow, we will take the dominant one, it will be, that is the round yellow. It is, this one is also round yellow, this one is wrinkled green. Wrinkled is the shape of the seed is wrinkled, and the color of the seed is green. See, this is also round yellow, this is also round yellow, but the difference is in their genotype. Phenotypically both are round yellow, but genotypically these are different. Now let's take now two individuals from the F1 generation. When we take two individuals from F1 generation, round and, right? When we take two individuals from F1 generation, we will do what? When we cross them, they will produce gamete independently. This will produce gamete R and R, round and wrinkle. And here the gametes will be produced yellow and green. Here again, same R and R. Right? So now here they will form certain combination. Certain combination they will form. So if I take the combination of the seed shape, first, if I take the combination of seed shape, understand, try to understand. The combination may be R and R. Right? The combination may be R and R, capital R, small r. Right? The combination may be again small r capital R, and the combination may be small r small r.
This is the combination.
This one, this possible four type of combination may be there. And if you take similarly y and y, the combination may be capital Y, small y, sorry, capital Y, capital Y, capital Y, capital Y, then again capital Y, small y, then again small y, capital Y, and again what is there? Small y, small y.
See the graph, see the flowchart is already started to look very haphazard. So in order to understand what we will do, we will make a square from here. We'll do a diagram of square. Okay, so let us take all the possible combination of the seed shape in one side. Okay, all the possible seed shape is possible combination of these two in one side, these two in one side, these two in one side, and these two in one side. So here if we take the combination here R and Y, again R and Y here. One whatever will be here, the same thing we will write here, R and Y. Again, here these two. R and Y. Okay, let me cite for another example. Yeah. The impure one we are taking. R and Y. Yeah, okay, don't worry. R and small y. What else is there? Small r, small y. And capital R, capital small y, smaller small y, smaller capital R, capital Y. Yeah, this should be small r, capital Y. Similarly, okay, let me draw it in a very broad way. You can understand here. So the gene combination you found here, where R and Y, right? In the previous we have seen the gene combination we have found here. So okay, let's start from here. So here this was the F1 generation, right? So from the F1 generation there can be a many possible from these two. If you consider the gametes may be capital R, small r, capital Y, small y. So now let's make a combination out of it. This can combine with this, right? This can combine with this, or this we have already done. This can combine with this. Again, this can combine with this. This can combine with this. Did you understand? Or let me show you again. I know it's a bit confusing. Okay, this will be the first filial generation. From these two gametes will be produced. From this two more. This get combined with this capital R, small r, this will can come with this capital R, small y. This will come with this small r capital Y, small r small y.
Now we will cross this again, but here this time we'll cross it in a square.
One, two, three, four. So capital R, small r. Again here also same capital R, small r. Small r capital Y. Small r capital Y. This one we have written. This one we have written. Again capital R small y. Capital R small y. And small r small y.
Now let us look at the combination. What combination they can necessarily form here? Oh, this should be y. I forgot. So here the combination may be R R Y Y. Capital R small r small y. Here again this one, if you make this one, there will be capital R small r capital Y capital Y. Here again capital R capital R capital Y small y. Here capital R capital Y small y. Here again small r capital Y again small r capital Y here r capital Y small y. Now again small r capital Y small y. Capital R capital R small y capital Y. Here again capital R capital R small y small y. Again capital R small r capital small y small y. Small r small y and capital Y. Now small r small y. Now how we'll understand all this? We have to understand, suppose take this one for example, small r capital Y small y. Here this one, here the dominant in case of seed shape is round, and in case of seed color is yellow, so it will be round yellow. So here suppose another one, if you take for example r r r y y, small r here both are recessive, it will be wrinkled and green. So after looking at all this graph or all the diagram, we see that the traits are get expressed in 9:3:3:1, right? The traits are get expressed in 9:3:3:1 means what? There will be 9 pure 9 green and wrinkled which will be impure, 9 green and wrinkled which will be impure, 3 green and wrinkled which will be again impure. If you look at the combination of gene, there will be 9 green and wrinkled, again 3 green and wrinkled, again 3 green and wrinkled, and 1 yellow wrinkled and green. So this will be the ultimate combination. So now next we'll discuss the next point is sex determination. Sex determination we will understand in a very short and a very simple way. For this we have to understand how many chromosomes are there in human body. So there are, we know, 23 pairs. 23 pairs or 46. But not all, now there are not all cell of our body has 23 pair of chromosome or 46. There are two different type of cell. One is the body cell and one is the germ cell or reproductive cell. So body cell have 23 pair of chromosome, that is 46 chromosome, and but germ cell have only 23 chromosome. Germ cell or the reproductive cell have only 23 chromosome. So this is twice n and this is n, means double of the chromosome here. So this one we say as haploid and this one we say as diploid. So how sex is determined? Okay, so here there will be one cell which will be responsible for sex determination and rest other are the body chromosomes. Sorry, one chromosome will be responsible. So suppose take the parents, father and mother. Now in father's case we will see it it contains X chromosome and mother will have XY chromosome. Sorry, father will have XY and mother will have XX chromosome. So as we have understood from gamete formation, this one will form the gamete of both X and Y and this one will form only the X gamete. So there will be two different type of combination here. If this one crosses with this one, it will form XX, and this one makes with combined with X1, this one will form XY. So again, if we look at the maternal side, or if we look at mother, we say mother have XX chromosome. Means what? If there is XX, this one will be female, and if there is again combination of XY, this one will be a male. So we see that the father has the variable different combination of gametes or different combination of genes, whereas mother have only X chromosome. There is both X and Y chromosome, there is only X chromosome. So father we see generally responsible to determine whether the baby to be born is a boy or a girl. Now next part is evolution. Evolution, I have said, is nothing but the development, or the, you know, from more complex, the development of animal from simple to more complex that takes place thousands of years. Now to understand evolution, we have to understand what is variation. Variation is nothing but the difference of offspring from parents. You look at yourself and your father and mother. You are more like your mother and father, but yet you will find that there are differences between yourself and your parents. So this difference is known as variation. Variation is what? The difference of characters from parents in the offspring. And evolution, I have already said, the process of gradual change from simple to more complex, which takes place over a thousands of years. The next point is speciation. Before understanding speciation, we have to understand what is species. Species are those group of organisms that can interbreed or reproduce among themselves, right? Those group of organisms that can reproduce among themselves are species, and those who cannot are not species. Suppose take a human and a chimpanzee, for example. They cannot breed, so they are different species. But a human and another human, a white man and a black man, they are species because they can breed among themselves. Alright, now speciation speciation is nothing but the formation of a new species. Now how a new species form? In your chapter we will see there are three processes responsible for speciation. One is geographical isolation. Next one is genetic drift. And the other one is natural selection. Geographical isolation means what? Geography means what? Something related with land. Isolation means what? When you isolate yourself or when you separate yourself, like you have now isolated yourself in your home. So when
a group of species, suppose a group of species A, so they are living in a particular place. So due to sudden, earthquake, so they are developed a river. And the population got divided into two separate places. So there is a geographical isolation here. So they are separate now and they are separate now. Right? They have their own environment. Now they are into two groups, A and B. Now A will not reproduce with B and B will not come in contact with A. So this will, you know, after a long period of time, we'll see that they have developed their separate gene pool. And they have developed their separate gene pool. And after thousands of years, we'll see that the individual of B place will not be able to reproduce with individual A place. And A place will similarly will not be able to reproduce with B place because they have developed their own way in their own environmental conditions. So this will give rise to two new species. Now next up is genetic drift. Genetic drift means what? The sudden change of gene frequency in a particular place. Suppose there is a place, so there are many red beetles and only few blue beetles. There are many red beetles and few blue beetles. Suddenly, suppose one day a herd of elephant came and they crushed many of these beetles. Now we see earlier the number of red beetles were more and green beetles, blue beetles were less. But now after a sudden accident, we saw that now the number of red beetles have decreased and green beetles also have decreased, but they are decreased in less number. So the gene frequency of a place has decreased suddenly. So this sudden change in the gene frequency will also give rise to a new species after a very long period of time. So this is also another means of speciation. The next is natural selection. Again, we'll take example of green and red beetle. Suppose there are a lot of red beetle in a place. Due to variation, one day there are a green beetle has evolved here. A new green beetle has emerged here. So take crow for example, crow will start eats the beetle. If the beetles are red, the visibility of the beetle to crow will be more. So the crow will eat the red beetle, but the green beetle will camouflage or hide with the green plant. So it got a natural advantage. So gradually crow will do what? It will eat all the red beetles and the green beetles will survive and they will start to reproduce. And this is because this is a natural advantages in green beetle. So we'll see there is a difference in the gene frequency and the green beetle will start to flourish and gradually they will give rise to a newer species. So this is natural selection because the nature has selected green beetles as an advantage and they have, you know, they started to flourish there. So these are the three ways of speciation. Now we will study the evidences of evolution. Now evolution, as I have mentioned before, is just a hypothesis. So there are certain evidence which, you know, proves the point of evolution. The first evidence we see, homologous and analogous. Now what is homologous and analogous? Homologous organs and analogous organs. So if you take two animals for example, so we will see that there are certain similarities in the animal irrespective of their structure, or we say there are similarities in structure irrespective of their use. So this proves the organism A and organism B were similar or were related in some point. In homologous organ we see what? The same structure of organs but different function. Structurally same, different function. Take for example, a forelimb of bat, forelimb of man and cheetah. Forelimb means what? The limbs, the hand and legs, these are called limbs. Means what? The upper portion, the limbs of the upper portion or the forward portion. So if you look at the forelimbs of the bat, we'll see they are structured with bones. Men also have bones in their hands. Cheetah also have bone in their leg. But the four limb of bird are developed to fly, are evolved to fly, whereas the four limb of men are able for grasping, means holding, and the four limb of cheetah are able from running. Both of the three four limb are made up of bone and they have similar structure, but they function differently. Now in analogous organ we see exact opposite, same function but different structure. Same function but different structure. Take bat and butterfly for example. Bat and butterfly both fly, both have wings, right? But the wings, the structure of bat wings is and structure of butterfly wing is different. The bat wings is, if you look at the basic structure, we have said it is made up of bone, whereas butterfly's wing does not have any bone. Both of them fly. This means what? Both of them have same function but different structure. Another one is fossil. Fossils means what? Fossils are the dead remaining of plants and animal that got preserved due to pressure of soil or rocks. So we have heard that about dinosaur. Where they have any people in the world have seen dinosaur? No, because they found their bodies and remaining of their parts preserved in the earth. So these are called fossil. Now what fossil proves? So fossil proves the ancestral structure or ancestral structure of animals. Suppose take giraffe for example. Once giraffe neck was as short like a horse, but when there was a shortage of grass in the ground, so they started to reach towards the tree. So as gradually due to evolution, the giraffe's neck started to grow, and this evidence we find in fossil. In fossil we see many related organism of the new organism, their ancestor we see in fossil. So fossil proves a very important evidence, gives a very important evidence about evolution. Now again, one more is evolution by stages. If you want to understand what is evolution by stages, you have to remember your evolution by stages. If you want to understand evolution by stages, you have to remember the class 9 chapter, that is diversity in living organism. Here we saw phylum, species, amphibia, reptile, apes, mammal. In species or in fishes we saw that they breathe with gill, but in amphibia we saw what? They breathe with both gill and lung. In reptile we see they breathe with lung, in ape they breathe with lungs, and in mammal they breathe with lung, right? If you take heart for example, the heart here is two chambered, the heart in amphibia are three chambered, and heart in reptiles are three chambered except crocodile, and here four, here also four. We see the heart and the lungs of each group of animals are getting evolved, you know, stage by stage. So this also prove evolution that occurs stage by stage. Now evolution and progress. Evolution and progress are two different things, right? Evolution should not be equated with progress. Progress means what? Suppose an organism A, it is developed into organism B and organism A is eliminated. No, organism A will be there. There will be certain group and it will form and evolve into organism B, but organism A still will be there. It's not like that it will get eliminated. If it was had to get eliminated, then it will be considered as progress. Evolution means what? Organism A will be there, but some of the group of organism will get evolved into organism B. Now tracing back human evolution. Now if you want to trace back human evolution, our most ancient DNA of human were traced back in Africa. So from Africa
we all the human beings of today's world, they their main ancestor were in Africa. So be it the red skin, be it the white skin, be it of any skin color, all were had their ancestor in Africa. So in Africa, so from Africa, a couple of thousands years ago, few of the migrant, not everybody, few of the migrated to West Asia. From there again to Central Asia. Right? From Central Asia they migrated, and then from Eurasia, then to South Asia. Right? And then they migrated to the islands of Indonesia, then Australia, and finally they crossed the Great Land Bridge and they reached America. So it's not like that all from Africa went to West Asia. No, a group of people from Africa they went to West Asia, then from West Asia a group went to Central Asia. So all of their left their traces, they left their roots in every places, and they migrated from one place to another, and that is how the human population spreaded across the whole world, right? So evolution should not be compared with, again, progress. Evolution is something which has various of branches, but progress means what? Developing from one species to another species, and at the same time the outdated species get eliminated. No, the outdated species remains. We see bacteria also exist, at the same time human also exist. So this proves that evolution is not equal to progress. So with this, this chapter came to an end. So you read the chapter and you read the notes, supplied notes, and if you have any doubt, please mention in the comment section below, and do subscribe to Al-Hira National School and click the bell icon so that you don't miss your class. Thank you. Have a good day.